Thank you, guys. Thank you all. Very blessed, man. We open our Bibles to Acts chapter 7 today. Acts chapter 7. Delaney, did you leave this up here? Acts chapter 7, our text for today begins with verse 17. Acts chapter 7, we'll begin reading with verse 17. In this series that we are doing through the book of Acts, we are hearing Stephen as he preaches his last sermon. Indeed, one wonders what will be the last thing that we ever say. What do you think the last thing you will ever say will be? We have no idea. It's God's timing. The one thing is sure, and that is that when we speak, let's be sure that it is spoken from a heart of compassion, a heart of urgency, a heart of expectancy. Because that's what Stephen does in this sermon. He speaks with compassion because it is his desire that lost men come to salvation. He speaks with urgency because at this moment in time, his life is in a pickle. But in the midst of the problems that he is facing, he recognizes that these men need to hear the gospel. They need to hear a word that is life-changing. They need to hear a word that will direct them toward the Lord Jesus Christ. He's been a servant, and urgency has been a part of his life for some time now. He's been urgently taking care of the widows, both the Hellenistic widows and the Hebrew widows. Stephen is a man of the Greek culture, so he's lived in the fast lane. He knows what urgency is all about. And as he speaks with a sense of urgency. As he speaks in this, he utilizes the longest portion of his sermon to focus on the man Moses. Now, he's been accused of blaspheming Moses. So he spends the most time on Moses. He's talked about Abraham. He's talked about Joseph, who had not been brought up in the accusations against him, but he had to bring them up because Abraham is the father of Judaism. Abraham is the father of these men to whom he is speaking. They are descendants of Abraham. And the promises that were made to Abraham had been fulfilled and were being fulfilled as Jesus Christ had come. Joseph, a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Joseph, a man who shows us what it means to be a deliverer, what it means to be rejected, and yet to deliver his people. What it means to be hated, and to be hated more as life goes on, and then sold into slavery. And then, when he sees his brothers for the first time after he has ascended to the place of the second man in Egypt, he has to go out of the room because his compassion has so overwhelmed him, and the tears begin to flow from his eyes, and he breaks down away from his brothers before he eventually reveals himself to his brothers. There's compassion in his heart for these who have betrayed him. There's compassion in his heart for these who have sold him into slavery. There's compassion in his heart for these who told Daddy he died. There's compassion in his heart for these. Compassion brings on urgency. There's some things that Stephen points out in this sermon that are very important for us today. When faced with the difficulties and the doubts of life, we need to recognize that God is in control and that nothing surpasses God. We live in difficult days. We live in days when it seems that all of life is out of control, but the one thing that we must know is God is in control. God knows what's going on, and God is preparing that which is going on. The second thing we need to recognize, as Stephen points out, is this world is not all that there is. This world will pass away, but God is eternal. And all of we who are in Him will inherit that eternal life. The third thing Stephen points out to us is that God is just and will make all things right by both rewarding the faithful and punishing the wicked. God calls us to make a difference in our world. We cannot make a difference in our world unless we know God is in control of our world. We cannot make a difference in our world until we recognize that this world is not all that there is, but there is another life that is yet to come. Resurrection life is how we live now as well as how we will live in the presence of God. And we'll not make a difference in our world unless we know that God's going to reward the faithful and punish the wicked. Joseph, Stephen, and Moses understand that. As Stephen begins to speak of Moses, he points out to us that God has revealed Himself again outside the Holy Land in a manner that is beyond our expectation and imagination. Can you imagine? The children of Israel, we're going to see, are in bondage, slavery. And yet God has a time. God has a process. God has a man that will lead these people in their deliverance. Egypt wasn't God's country. In fact, God did not want His people going down into Egypt until the famine came and the drought came, and they had to go down into Egypt to find life. Egypt, used throughout Scripture, speaks to us of sin. It speaks to us of the world. And yet here are God's people in the world being enslaved by the things of the world. Does that sound familiar at all to any of us? We live in this world, and too often we are enslaved by the things that we encounter in this world. And yet God knows where they are, and God will be with His people, and God will deliver His people. Once again, we're going to see in Stephen's sermon this call that the church has to go into all the world and to preach the gospel. I'm setting this up for 3 weeks from now when we'll finish the sermon. Or maybe four. But it is important for us to understand that as Stephen preaches this message, his heart, his desire is to see the salvation of these who think they are God's people but are not, but who can be God's people through Jesus Christ. Let's look at Acts chapter 7. Let's begin with verse 17. But as the time of the promise was approaching, which God had assured to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt, until there arose another king over Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph. It was he who took shrewd advantage of our race and mistreated our fathers so that they would expose their infants and they would not survive. It was the time that Moses was born, and he was lovely in the sight of God, and he was nurtured 3 months in his father's home. And after he had been set outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him away and nurtured him as her own son. Moses was educated in all the learning of the Egyptians, and he was a man of power in words and deeds. But when he was approaching the age of 40, it entered his mind to visit his brethren, the sons of Israel, and when he saw one of them being treated unjustly, he defended him and took vengeance for the oppressed by striking down the Egyptian. Verse 25. And he supposed that his brethren understood that God was granting them deliverance through him, but they did not understand. On the following day, he appeared to them as they were fighting together, and he tried to reconcile them in peace, saying, "Men, you are brethren, why do you injure one another?" But one who was injuring his neighbor pushed him away, saying, "Who made you a ruler and judge over us? You did not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you?" At this remark, Moses fled and became an alien in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. After 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in the flame of a burning thorn bush. When Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight, and he approached to look more closely. There came a voice from the Lord. "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob." Moses shook with fear and would not venture to look. The Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt, and have heard their groanings, and I have come down to rescue them. Come now, and I will send you to Egypt." The story of Moses continues on, but we will see that next Sunday. But I want us to spend some time with these things that Stephen has said regarding Moses as he addresses the Sanhedrin, while Stephen is convicted of blaspheming Moses and vilifying the temple. Note how verse 17 begins. "But as the time of the promise was approaching." The time of promise was approaching. At the end of near 400 years of enslavement, no one of the Israelites in Egypt seemed to be keeping a calendar. They didn't seem to be keeping up with, when will this promise take place? When will the promise that God made to Abraham become our promise? And when will we celebrate our new home in a land of promise? It seems there's no record of anyone in Israel seeking to keep up with the time of the promise that God had made to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15. But God was keeping time. God was keeping time, and that's where we can all find an opportunity to be thankful. God was keeping the time. He knew his people. He knew where they were. He knew what was going on in their lives, and he had made a promise. And when God is keeping time, we know that the promise that God makes is secure and certain, and that deliverance will come because of that security that we have. Let me ask you a question. Has anyone ever asked you, why was Jesus born in the time that he was born? I've had some ask me that question. A good friend of mine asked me that question once, before he became a Christian. Why was Jesus born in the time that he was born? Why was Jesus born in a time when there wasn't a lot of media attention? Why was Jesus born to an unmarried couple? Why was Jesus laid in the manger of a stable? Why was Jesus born in the insignificant city of Bethlehem? Why was Jesus born in the insignificant place of Judea? It meant very little in the Roman Empire. Why was Jesus born there? The only answer I have is because it was God's timing. God has a time and a place and a way. And I think that the time and the place and the way of Jesus' birth speaks to us of the fact that even in insignificance, God knows us, loves us, and leads us. God provided a Savior in a time when Judea was an insignificant land. But even when Israel is under the bondage of Egypt, the time of promise which God had assured to Abraham came to pass. Scripture tells us that the sons of Israel were fruitful and increasing greatly and multiplied and became exceedingly mighty so that the land was filled with them. And here's the problem, according to verse 18. There arose another king over Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph. This new king, who did not know Joseph, who did not know the wonder of what he had done for the land of Egypt, this new king who was fearful of the Israelites because of the number of people that they were. His fear, Scripture tells us in Exodus chapter 1, his fear was that these sons who had multiplied would align themselves with an enemy of Egypt, and Egypt would be overcome. You see, the Israelites lived in the best of the land. They lived in the land of Goshen. They lived in a fruitful land. They lived in a land that the Nile River created an area that was well-watered and a grassland that was perfect for being herdsmen. It was a great and wonderful place for them to dwell. But have you stopped to think about the fact that this land where they dwelt, this northern area of Egypt, was actually a trade route between Egypt and Canaan? Now, Pharaoh was concerned that they would join any marauding army that would come from the north and that they would band with them and overcome Egypt, because this had happened in Egypt's history. But here's my greater concern. Why had Israel not thought, now that we are strong and now that we are mighty, isn't this the time we should go back to the land of Canaan, the land of promise? But they gave no thought to going back to the land of promise. In fact, when the famine ended and when drought subsided, they became accustomed to the ever-flowing waters of the Nile Crescent and the lush pastures of the region, and they became comfortable. Comfortable. They were happy with their life. This is nice. We're becoming wealthy. We're having a good life. And because of this good life, they wanted to go nowhere. Even when they became slaves and all of the difficulties that they went through, later on they're going to think back on their life in Egypt and they're going to go, why didn't we stay there? We understood life. We were comfortable with life. We knew how to get along. We knew what was required of us. We knew what to do. We knew how to do it. And we still had plenty of food and water and everything that we need. May I say to you, when we become comfortable with life, God will need to make us uncomfortable if He has a plan for us that is outside the boundaries of that comfort. We need to take heed in the good times. Because in the good times, remember where they were? They weren't in Canaan, they were in Egypt. They were in the world. They were in a land of sin. They had false gods surrounding them on every hand. And they were comfortable. The Sanhedrin had become comfortable with the situation that they were in. They were under Roman authority, yes, but they were in control of those things that made their life comfortable. Have we as God's people become so comfortable with the world in which we dwell today that we have forgotten the call of God to go into the world and preach the gospel? Have we become so comfortable with the world in which we live that we identify more with the people of the world than we do with the promises God has made to His chosen? We need to take heed in comfortable times. And I think that's what Stephen is saying to these men. And I cannot help but think that Sanhedrin is hearing this message. We're really comfortable with what we can control. And we know what we can't control, so we just ignore it. And we control what we can control. Well, for Israel in Egypt, when they became so comfortable, the only way God could move them is to create hard times. Have you ever noticed when hard times come, we become more religious? Life gets in a pickle. Life gets in a fix. Life gets into a situation where we can't figure it out. And the first thing we do is, well, I've got to pray about this. Sometimes life can get so difficult for us that I guess I need to go to church Sunday. I guess I need to do those things that will, in some way or another, grab the attention of God and let Him look at me and where I am and who I am. God sent hard times to Israel, and Israel began to call on God for a deliverer. As these hard times continued, Israel began to pray that they would be delivered from their slavery. Sanhedrin is hearing this, and as they do, they're thinking about their own people, and one of the things that they would think about is that as Rome is in control of Palestine during this period of time, there are a number of messiahs who are raising up, and people are beginning to follow after all these messiahs. Remember back when Peter was accused of being a rabble-rouser, and Gamaliel takes his defense, and he basically says, you remember these two guys who rose up, said they were Messiah, but when they were defeated by the Romans, their people stopped following them. Messiahs were rising up during this time. Life in Jerusalem, Judea, and Galilee. That life was actually compared to the slavery in Egypt by many who spoke during that time. Difficulties, troubles, hard times. Our nation's been living in a pretty good time. I'm not political, but I have to make this observation. Our nation has been living in some pretty good times. But do you hear what the economic prophets are saying? They're saying we're in store for a hard time. Recession and other things. And as people begin to think about that, they begin to become afraid, to become scared. Let me say to you, perhaps it's a good time for us to pray that the Lord will deliver us from these difficult times, or that the Lord will awaken His people to what really matters. What really matters? Is a comfortable life what really matters to you? Or is the message of salvation for the lost what matters to you? To say that there's something beyond this world and a life that is yet to come. Hard times. When hard times come, it's important for us to note, according to verse 19, that God does not always choose a convenient time for the birth of His chosen one. Verse 19 refers to Pharaoh when it says, "It was he who took shrewd advantage of our race and mistreated our fathers so that they would expose their infants and they would not survive." This is not a time for a Messiah to be born. But verse 20 says, "It was at this time that Moses was born." In a time when they were killing the infants, a time of infanticide, when Moses was born, Pharaoh had sought the death of male infants, according to Exodus chapter 1. Exodus chapter 1 tells us about two Hebrew midwives who determined that they would not expose these infants being born. They would not follow Pharaoh's orders. They actually said to Pharaoh, these women are so strong, the babies are born before we get there. Well, when you consider the work the Israelites were having to do, they probably were. But these women would protect these children. They were not going to lay them outside. They were not going to cast them into the Nile River as they had been requested to do. These midwives were leaving the male infants. Kind of interesting that Stephen brought that up. Because you see, at that same time, non-Jewish people in and around Jerusalem, Judea, and other places where they lived, non-Jewish people who did not want their children were leaving them outside, exposed to elements so that they would die. This wasn't a happenstance thing that Stephen mentions this here. It wasn't a historical thing that causes Stephen to mention this here. It was a cultural thing that Stephen spoke to when he said they were told to leave them outside to expose them so that they would die. That was going on in their day. By the way, if you're going to speak the Word of God, speak the Word of God to the situation in which you live. Stephen speaks this word. Luke uses that term, set outside. It was a well-chosen phrase because of what was going on in their world at that time. So Moses should have been left outside. Does that remind you of anything regarding Jesus Christ? When Jesus was born, it wasn't a good time, was it? When Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the Magi came looking for this king of the Jews, and they stopped off at Herod's palace. And they said, "Where's the one born king of the Jews?" And Herod went, "I don't know, but I sure like to find out." With the excuse of, "I want to worship him," with the intent of, "I want to murder him." When the Magi find the Christ child, they see the Christ child, they witness the Christ child, they worship the Christ child, and then they are led another way. When they leave the Christ child, they do not go back to Herod's temple. And so Herod, when he recognizes what is going on, he sends out his men and says, "Go to Bethlehem and kill every infant." And he gives them an age range. Kill every infant. Jesus was born in a time when even his own life was in danger. The death of Moses was an order of Pharaoh that would not be carried out. Because even though God had chosen a difficult time for Moses to be born, nothing in our life is an accident. God is sovereign, and nothing in one's life is wasted. In verses 20 and 21, it was a time that Moses was born, and he was lovely in the sight of God. A good-looking baby. It's wonderful to see a beautiful baby born, isn't it? I've seen some babies born, and I've had to go, "Oh, isn't that one lovely?" But Moses was a lovely baby in the eyes of God. And obviously in the eyes of Pharaoh's daughter, because after he had been set outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him away and nurtured him as her own son. You know the story. I don't have to tell you the story. Moses is born 3 months later after he's born. His mother, knowing that the child would be thrown into the Nile River, prepares a ark of bulrushes, pitches that ark so he will not sink, puts that ark and the baby into the river Nile. She sets him outside, as she has to do, but it's a well-chosen place. I've always wondered if Moses' mother wasn't a good CIA person. If she didn't scout out the Nile River to see where she was going to put the baby. Or was this just the providence of God that the baby be laid at the place where Pharaoh's daughter would come to bathe? Let me tell you, I don't care which way you want to go with that story. It was an act of God. Because God puts desires into our heart. He puts ideas into our mind. He directs our paths, does He not? And when He chooses, He can do it without our even having a clue what we're doing when we put the baby into the water. Pharaoh's daughter comes along. Now, the irony of this just gets away from me. Pharaoh's daughter, her daddy said that all Hebrew males were to be killed. She comes along, she sees the basket, she sees the baby, she goes, wow, this is a beautiful baby. And she has a desire in her heart to protect this child. She's going to take this child. The Hebrew says she adopted this child as her own. Now, can you imagine? Daddy said, kill all the Hebrew babies. And here comes the daughter along who says, but this one is special. This one is lovely. This one I'm going to make mine. Again, God puts desires in hearts. Again, God changes minds. Again, God uses circumstances and situations, because I've always said, when she went on to Pharaoh to say, I'm going to adopt this Hebrew child, Pharaoh looked at her and went, yes, dear. I have yet to see a daughter who couldn't convince her dad to do whatever it was she wanted done. Pharaoh now becomes a protector of a Hebrew infant when he wants all the people, the males. The irony of this is that the children would be cast into the Nile for death, but the Nile River was the life of Egypt. In fact, the name means life. And so in the life of Egypt, they were causing death for those who were God's chosen. By the way, the world would be happy to destroy the people of God, the ways of the world and the sin of the world, the evil of the world. We can trust God to weave together all of our hard times, all of our educational opportunities, and all of our life experiences to equip us for the kingdom of God and His work. Raised in Pharaoh's house, educated in the Gentile school of the Pharaohs, the experiences of his life, all woven together, brings Moses to the place to lead God's people. Around 40 years of age, Moses is going to make a decision that would change the course of his life and the future of Israel. In verses 23 through 29, we find that Prince Moses goes out. This is probably where he began to learn humility. He goes out and he sees an Egyptian creating difficulty as he is striking an Israelite, and Moses goes to protect the Israelite because he has a heart for his people. And when he goes, he winds up killing the Egyptian and burying him, hoping that this will hide the fact of what he has done. The next day, Moses goes out and he encounters two Israelites who are fighting with one another. And he goes over to stop that fight, and when he goes over to stop that fight, some things take place. Now, I want you to think about this. Moses made a decision, but he didn't consult God. Moses made a decision, took action, but he didn't consult God. When we take steps to make a decision that would change the course of our life, if we take those steps without consulting God, if we run ahead of God, we're going to find the same problem that Moses found. The first is, he had no authority. The Israelite who was winning the battle, said to Moses, "Who made you a ruler and judge over us?" Well, God's going to make him a ruler and a judge, but at that point in time, Moses has no power over these people, no authority over these people. And because of that, he's on a downward spiral of defeat. You see, it's only God's authority that gives us the ability to serve. If we take steps without consulting God, we will be misunderstood. The man says, not only, "Who made you ruler over us?" He said, "You do not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you?" Verse 26. You see, God makes himself understood through us. But when we get ahead of God, sometimes we're not understood. The third thing that happens out of this is facing consequences. The consequence that he faces is that he's going to be overrun by this circumstance, and he's going to have to flee, to move away. Moses fled and became an alien in the land of Midian. He fled in fear because he could not move forward in confidence because he ran out of God. Moses was willing to sacrifice his place in Pharaoh's house, but only to find that those whom he sought to deliver would reject him. If a person or a people lose sight of God's promises and plans, they often reject what God's doing. Israel didn't see Moses as a leader because they weren't thinking about God's plan. Moses didn't understand what he was doing because he wasn't thinking about God's plan. God's plan is for Moses to spend the next 40 years in the land of Midian. He goes to the land of Midian, and there he meets Jethro, the priest, and he lives in Jethro's home, and he shepherds Jethro's sheep, and during that 40 years, life is becoming very comfortable. He's married one of Jethro's daughters. He has a couple of sons. He knows what his duties are. He knows where he's going. He knows what every day is going to be like. He has the comfort of being provided for. He has all of these things working for him. He gets comfortable until the day God shows him a thorn bush burning. God intervenes. God shows up. God says, "You've become too comfortable. Now I must make you uncomfortable." Moses, who was educated, said, "I can't speak." Moses, who was educated, says, "How can I lead this people?" Moses, who had been glorified as a general in Egypt in days past by the historians of that day, Moses feels as though he has no effective means of leading Israel. But God says, "I've already worked that out. Aaron will be your spokesman. You will tell them I am has sent me. You will lead this people." You see, never become impatient. Never doubt God's plan. Never try to implement your own agenda. But patiently wait on God's timing. Humbly trust and obey. God will hear his people, and they are now ready for one to deliver them. And according to verse 34, he sends Moses. You see the similarities between Moses and Jesus? The people of God are oppressed. The birth of a deliverer in an unusual circumstance and time. And God stepping in to protect his chosen one. God always sees the plight of his people and delivers in his time, according to his plan, in a way that is better than anything we can devise. By the way, what enslaves you? What enslaves you? The call of salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, is that call that frees us from the slavery that is in our life to sin and to the world and to running ahead of God. In Christ alone, there is life, there is hope, and today we're going to celebrate that in observing this Lord's Supper. I want you to take the packet of your meal. And in this, I want us to understand that this represents the relationship that we have with Christ. It is a relationship in which His body is broken for us and His blood was shed for us. It is a relationship where He is the bread of life. It is a relationship in which the life is in the blood. It is a relationship that says to us, I know where you are, and I know who you are, and I know what's going on in your life, but I am here for you. Today, as we receive this meal, I want us to think of the presence of God in our life and the circumstances of our life today. You may be facing a difficulty that you won't share with anyone. You may be facing a difficulty that says to you that you are powerless. It says to you there seems to be no hope. It says to you there seems to be no future. You may be facing a circumstance that says, I am so concerned about others that I don't know what to do. I want to step in and I want to change their life in any way that I can. You may be facing some good times. Life may have finally come together. Or it's been together for a while. And you're celebrating the goodness that life has brought to you. And you've come to the place that you've become so satisfied with the way that life is until you kind of shut yourself away from the hurts of others and the needs of others. Receiving this meal today reminds us that Christ is with us in those circumstances. That He has come to be our deliverer. That He has come to be our Savior. That He has come to, by His Holy Spirit, to be with us, to carry us through the circumstances of our life. Let's open this packet and take from it the bread. As we receive this bread today, we know that our Savior came in a time when the world wasn't ready for Him. Our Savior came in a time when mankind needed a Savior. Our Savior came to you and me when we needed Him most. As we receive this bread today, He unites us together as His people, as His church, to serve Him, to honor Him, to seek Him, to walk with Him and according to His time, send the gospel out into all the world that all may hear. And it's because of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. Jesus said, this is my body, given for you. As after you eat this, do this in remembrance of me. And then He took the cup. And as He took the cup, He said to His disciples, this is my blood. So after you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. In the receiving of this bread and this cup, I recognize, as do you, that these are symbolic of the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But let that symbolism remind us of the reality of the indwelling Spirit. that we may walk with Him and honor Him. This morning, we're going to offer an invitation. And in this invitation time, I want to ask you to examine in your heart and in your life your relationship with Jesus Christ. Where are you in life at this moment in time? Is this a time in which God needs to step in and make Himself known? Is this a time when you will earnestly seek to serve Him? Wherever life is at this moment in time, it is a time to yield to His perfect will. Would you stand with me as we sing this hymn of invitation and the Spirit of God moves upon you? Come to the altar to pray if you wish. Come to commit your life to Christ if you wish. Come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior if you do not. Seek the Lord in this moment. Us ever become so comfortable that we do not see the perfect will of God, the purpose of God, the call of God. Let us ever become so comfortable that a wilderness is home. Let us never become so comfortable that bondage is pleasant. Let us never become so comfortable that the world becomes sacred. May God make us uncomfortable, that we may seek Him with all our heart, and that we may see Him when He works in our lives. Father, may Your grace and Your peace be upon Your people this day. By the indwelling of Your Holy Spirit, Father, convict us, convince us, secure us, sanctify us, and set us up on that course to share the gospel with our world. Or whether through Joseph, or Moses, or Stephen, or any one of us, men may see Jesus and know that He is the Deliverer, that He is the Messiah, that He is the Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you for being here.